Praise God. Hey, youth is dismissed at this time. I think, where are y'all meeting at? In the back? They're meeting in the back tonight. Hey, Joy. Praise the Lord. Is everybody doing all right tonight? Amen. Praise God. Well, tonight, we're going to have the opportunity to hear from one in our own house tonight. It's something I'm going to try to incorporate throughout this year, is I'm going to give other ministers in the house the opportunity to minister every month, maybe trying to get them worked in, and because I know how it is to be called to minister and not be able to minister. Amen. And so tonight, Brother Tyson's going to come up and give us a word, and the next month we're going to have somebody else, and the next month, and the next month, and we're just going to keep having somebody come in and minister, and I believe it's good. I believe it's healthy for the house to hear from other people, and it gives me an opportunity to receive as well. Amen. And I am not above receiving, understand me, and if you ever think you're in a place where you don't need to receive, you probably need to be the first one at the altar. God can always pour into us as long as we allow ourselves to be an open vessel. Amen. Amen. So tonight, as he's getting ready to come up, how about looking at somebody and say, hey, I am a house of prayer. Oh, yeah. I am a house of prayer. Come on up, Brother Tyson. Give him a hand clap tonight. Amen. Praise God.
Amen. Praise God. She can? Sure. Who's set free in here tonight? Amen. Are you free? Are you free indeed? Amen. That's right, because the sun set you free. Amen. You know, you wouldn't be free if the sun hadn't done it. Praise God. You know, I got sober one time, and I was sober about 2 years before I got saved, but I was thirsty all the time. Anybody that's ever been an alcoholic knows what I'm talking about. But then I stumbled in a church high one Sunday on Easter, and God set me free indeed. What he did was he took the want to out of me. Amen. In other words, I can go in the liquor store and witness now because I don't want to no more. Amen. Everybody got that? Say amen. Now, I'm not going in there unless the Lord directs. Because he also gave me wisdom. Praise God. Stand up for the reading of God's word. We're going to start in Genesis. We're going to go way back to Genesis 37. Tonight, I want to preach lessons from the pit. Lessons from the pit. And I think, man, what a great time to have this opportunity to bring the Word of God right in the middle of a fast. Amen. You know that Daniel ate according to the Levitical law, which is the way Jesus ate. So the diet or the meals that we're able to eat right now, same thing Jesus ate. Praise God. And if you notice, at the end of this fast, you're going to feel better. You're going to look better. You're actually going to have more energy than you started with. Amen? Because there's something about doing what the Word of God says, even when you don't have to. Everybody got that? Say amen. Genesis 37, verse 19. I think I can read this comparative study Bible. The print small. Amen. And when they saw him afar off, even before he came near unto them, they conspired against him to slay him. And they said one to another, behold, this dreamer cometh. Come now, therefore, and let us slay him and cast him into some pit. You notice they didn't even pick one out. Just any pit was going to be fine. And we will say some evil beast hath devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams. And Reuben heard it, and he delivered him out of their hands and said, let us not kill him. And Reuben said unto them, shed no blood, but cast him into this pit that is in the wilderness, and lay no hand upon him, that we might rid him out of their hands, to deliver him to his father again. And it came to pass, when Joseph was coming to his brethren, that they stripped Joseph out of his coat of many colors that was on him. And they took him and cast him into the pit. And the pit was empty. There was no water in it. Turn to your neighbor and say, it was dry. Turn to your other neighbor now and say, there was no water in it. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you right now, Lord God, for this opportunity to share your word. I pray, Lord, that every person under the sound of my voice right now, Lord God, have the anointing of God on them and in them. I pray, Lord God, that every ear be open, every eye and every heart, Lord God, to see, hear, and receive what you prepared for them tonight. Lord, I think that you've preached a very important message to us tonight for this time at Abundant Life and Foresight. And Lord, even though things look like they're not going well, Lord, we know we're going forward. And Father, sometimes, Lord, we got to back up to go forward. And Lord, sometimes we have to slow down to pick up speed. But Lord, we're believing you tonight. Lord, you're going to do great and mighty things. We come with an expectation of great and mighty works. We want to see people set free, healed, and delivered tonight. We want to see people born again in the Son of God. We want to see Jesus do a work that only he can do. Lord, we want to see the transformation of lives. That's what we're here for. We're not here to just fellowship. We're not here just to sharpen each other's iron. We're here, Lord, tonight to see lives changed. Lord, if there's anybody under the sound of my voice that don't have Jesus, they need him. And if there's anybody here that already has him, they need more of him. And I pray that both those things take place in the Spirit. And in advance, we give you glory for it. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. You can be seated. Praise God. Go ahead and give God some praise in here. Amen. Crisis. Anybody in here ever had a crisis? If you hadn't, see me after the service. Because I want to get your secret. Amen. 55 years old, I lived through some crisis. I've lived through quite a few of them. As a matter of fact, when I got saved there in the beginning, I didn't think I was going to have any crisis. I thought they were all over with. But after I got good and wet in the anointing of God and began to seek the Lord with all my might, I noticed there was an enemy, and he didn't like me. As a matter of fact, we have that in common. He don't like me, and I don't like him. We're enemies. Come on, somebody. And I believe tonight that God's going to show us something very important about being in a crisis. As a matter of fact, crisis happens when you least expect it. I mean, you can't pencil in a crisis. Like, in your iPhone, you can't put, I'm going to schedule a crisis in February. It's just not something that happens. As a matter of fact, it comes out of nowhere. You go to one doctor's appointment, crisis. You get one phone call, crisis. It can change your life forever. One intersection, just trying to start your car one cold morning, crisis. Everybody knows what I'm talking about. They can be huge and they can be small, but they can change your life forever. How do you handle or react to global or personal crisis in your life? How do you do that? I mean, I want to ask you tonight, think for yourself just a minute, how do you handle a crisis? A lot of people, unfortunately, in the church and out, find themselves in a pit of despair, a pit of depression, a pit of self-pity. Let me tell you right now who comes to a pity party. You and the devil. That's the only two people that want to attend it, I can tell you. So don't start feeling sorry for yourself, because that's where the devil wants you. If you're a child of God, you got to live as a child of God in a crisis and out of it. Amen? You got to be a child of God in the valley as well as on the mountaintop. It's easy to shout praise on the mountaintop. It's hard to shout praise at the funeral home. But as a child of God, we can do both. If you believe that, say amen. A lot of times we get in a pit of regret. Man, if we just wouldn't have. If we'd have done something different. If I would have. If I could have. Or should have. Come on, somebody. We get in that pit, man. The devil gets you in there. And if you don't think that's a dry place, you get on in there, because there ain't no water in that. Self-pity and regret is the driest pit you can get thrown into. And the devil, once you get in there, he's going to remind you every second that you're in there why you're in there. Come on, somebody. He ain't going to help you out. The devil don't help you up. He trips you up. He don't help you get a hand up. He tries to keep his hand down on you. Amen? Running never works. Some people want to run from everything. They tell me, I'm going to move to South Carolina and start over. Show me what city in South Carolina ain't got no crisis. Every time there's a tragedy, people say, well, things like that just don't happen around here. Things like that happen everywhere, church. There's no place immune from it. We look at the problem. If you run, you can't look at the problem, and the problem's usually, guess what? You. Come on. You know how I got sober? I had a counselor tell me one day, you're the problem. Now, I blamed everybody. Come on, somebody. I'd blame where I lived. I'd blame my parents. I'd blame my brother. I'd blame my sister. I blamed everybody. I blamed Jack Daniels. I blamed Budweiser. I blamed every liquor store that ever opened up. I blamed everybody until I had a counselor say, you know what the problem is? You. You're the problem. Church, a lot of times we sit in church and we say, man, I hope she hears that. She needs it. I hope that brother gets that because he needs that. But what we need to do when we sit in church is work on us. I have never, and Pastor can attest to this, I have never preached a sermon when God didn't speak to me. Look, I write it out when the Lord delivers it to me. I study it. I add things to it. You never have enough. Amen. And during that whole time, God hardly ever says anything to me, but right in the middle of preaching, God will say, that's for you. And y'all don't even know it, but I know it. I just keep rolling. I'm like, okay, Lord. In my spirit, I'm like, okay, Lord, I got it. A lot of times we look at the problem on the outside, but we fail to see the bigger problem on the inside. My daughter, my oldest daughter, was raised in church. I tell everybody she had a drug problem. Every time she looked up, she's getting drugged into church. We took her to everything. I went to every revival, whether it was in North Georgia, South Georgia, Middle Georgia. We went to every revival. She was in every youth camp that had a youth camp. I put her in every one of them. And when she seen people cussing or smoking, man, it just got all over. She's like, Daddy, they cussing and smoking. I'm like, I know, babe, but I want you to remember something. There's sins that are on the outside of people that we see. Listen to me, church. And we can condemn those people. We can say, oh, they sinning. But there's people that sit in church every Sunday that's got some pretty filthy bowls. Jesus told the Pharisees, you like whitewashed sepulchers full of dead men's bones. He said, you may clean the outside of the cup, but inside the cup there's all manner of evil. Come on, somebody. So I said, Kristen, don't be so hard on people just because they outwardly sin, because there's people sitting among us that are greedy and prejudiced, and they covet and they hate. There's all kinds of things that happen on the inside of people. Look, church, what we got to fix first is the inside, and it'll come out of the outside. If you believe that, say amen. The foundation of law and order, truth and justice, morality, decency, is really being destroyed in society because nobody's standing up for it. Vance Havner said, nowadays a liar is just an extrovert with a lively imagination. A murderer is just a victim of traumatic experience. His mother wouldn't let him push his oatmeal off his baby chair, so he decides he'll push his wife off the Brooklyn Bridge. Havner went on to say, my father would let me sit up late on Saturday night before the open fire, while he and the minister talked long and late about the things of God. And they built a wall around my soul that the world, the flesh, and the devil could not breach, and deposited a sediment of conviction in my soul that has stood the test of years. Church, nothing is better than you living it out and walking it out before your kids. If you want to be a witness, then quit complaining and start being a triumphant, overcoming, devil-stomping, tongue-talking child of God. And let your kids know it. Amen? I want to talk about a man who had a reason to blame others for his situation. Man, if anybody had a reason, it was this guy. But instead, he made the best out of every crisis he found himself in. I titled this message, Lessons from the Pit, because there's much to be learned from this man and his pit experience. As a matter of fact, I don't think there's a better example in the Word of God than who Joseph is. As a matter of fact, Joseph never lost his volume, and he never lost his value. He never shut up, and he never let the devil tell him who he was. Now, he might have got thrown in a dry pit. Come on, somebody. But it didn't stop him from praising God. It didn't stop him from witnessing. Look, he might have got in a pit for a minute. But one thing I know about Joseph is that he knew he wasn't going to stay there long. And you might be in a pit right now, but I got good news for you. You ain't got to stay there long. And sometimes a pit experience may last a while. And I know when my family was lost when I first got saved, and I prayed and prayed, and they got worse and worse. The more I prayed, the more they drank. They did start pouring it in some red Solo cups when I went down there, hiding it from me. When I used to pastor a church, I'd walk outside, somebody would be smoking it. Brother, put that cigarette behind you. Smoke would be trailing up behind you. I'd be like, brother, you don't have to hide that from me, because the one that matters saw you when you bowled. Come on, somebody. They'll be throwing stones at me. If you smoke and quit, come on, somebody. The best way to quit smoking is quit putting the brown end in your mouth and lighting the white end. That's the best way to quit, and that's a fact, Jack. And God will help you do that. But look, I got delivered from methamphetamine. I got delivered from alcohol. I got delivered from every pill you could ever imagine. But when it come to getting delivered from Winston Ultra Lights, that was a battle and a half. But I can tell you this, I'm smoke-free and have been for 23 years. Give God praise for that. Amen. And there was a time when I had one in my mouth and one in my hand, both of them lit. I'm not even kidding about that. That's how bad I smoked. So you can quit. That's a pit. Amen. They had a 12-step program at my church one time, and I walked in, and they all talking about getting free, and all of them going outside and smoking. I said, you brothers ain't free yet, because that cigarette smoke can kill you. That's the truth, church. Don't get mad at me now. Hear me? I'm just telling you the truth, Pastor. Ain't that right? Look, Jesus said, I come to give you life and it more abundantly. He didn't say, I come to give you life and it smell like smoke. Joseph never lost his volume and he never lost his value. Jeremiah 7, 2 through 10. Now, Jeremiah was called the weeping prophet. You want to talk about another guy that could have gave it up? Jeremiah, look, God said, Jeremiah, you go down to church and tell everybody at the church they ain't living right. That's the Roach translation. He said, you go down there and stand up and tell them if they don't repent, that I'm going to burn them all up and they're going to live in hell the rest of their existence. That's a hard job, Pastor. I mean, people are mad at me right now just because I preach against smoking. Jeremiah 7:2 says, stand in the gate of the Lord's house and proclaim there his word. And say, hear the word of the Lord, all ye in Judah that enter in at the gates to worship the Lord. Look, when you see the word Lord capitalized in these scriptures right here, that's where Jehovah would say. It would say Jehovah. And it says, thus saith Jehovah of hosts. That's the Lord of armies, the God of Israel. Amend your ways and your doings, and I will cause you to dwell in this place. Trust ye not in lying words, saying the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord are these. In other words, don't go to everything. You know, there's a movement right now that we can coexist with every religion. That we have to be in the soup with the Mormons and the Jehovah's Witnesses and the Muslims. Let me tell you something, church. There's one faith, one God, one baptism. One. And it's here under the blood of Jesus Christ. No other religion in the world even exist. There's only one faith, and it's the Lord Jesus Christ dying on a bloody tree to set us free. Give God praise if you believe that tonight. For if you thoroughly amend your ways and your doings, if you get your life straightened out with the help of the Holy Ghost, because you can't do it on your own. If you thoroughly execute judgment, in other words, between a man and his neighbor, in other words, do the right thing, say the right thing, even if it costs you something. You've got to tell people what the Word of God says. Not what Oprah says, not what Dr. Phil says, not what the World News Tonight says. You got to tell people what the Word of God says. If the Word of God says it ain't right, and God ain't changing it. Somebody give Him praise if you believe it. Do not oppress the stranger, the fatherless, or the widow. Shed not innocent blood in this place. Neither walk after other gods to your hurt. You hear that warning? Go ahead and go down to the Mormon temple and see what you end up with. Go on to the Jehovah's Witnesses and see what you end up with. Oh, yeah, they'll tell you they just like you. They'll give you your booklet. The best thing to do with that thing, this is what I do when a Jehovah's Witness gives me a booklet. I just tear that thing up and throw it at their feet. Come on, somebody. And they'll say, well, what'd you do that for? I'll say, well, it's garbage, and I didn't want to put it in my house. I got enough garbage towed off. That's hearsay. One told me one time, well, I hope you can respect me, my faith, and I'll respect yours. I said, your faith damns men's souls to hell and ruins their lives. I can't respect that. They don't come by my house much after they come. The last time they come, Robin asked Alyssa what they said when I went out there, and Alyssa said, not much. Come on, somebody. God made me small, but He made me a little talker. Come on. Well, I mean, short. Getting smaller, though, eating like Jesus ate. Amen. Glory. That's a byproduct. Then I will cause you to dwell in this place in the land that I gave your fathers forever and ever. Behold, you trust in lying words that cannot profit. Will you steal, murder, commit adultery, and swear falsely, and burn incense unto Baal, and walk after other gods whom you know not, and come and stand before me in this house, which is called by my name, and say, we are delivered to do all these abominations? Church, you want the blessings? Get the junk out of your life. He proclaimed, he witnessed, he praised, and he prayed. Romans 15:6, that you may with one mind and one mouth glorify God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Wherefore receive you one another as Christ also received us to the glory of God. Now I say that Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision, that's of the Jews, for the truth of God to confirm the promises made unto the fathers, the Old Testament saints, and that the Gentiles might glorify God for His mercy. You know what a Gentile is? Turn to your neighbor and say, you're a Gentile. Glory to God. And that the Gentiles might glorify God for His mercy. That's what we did when Molly and the praise team was up here praising. We were praising Him for His mercy. Amen. We were giving Him glory. Y'all believe that? Let me tell you, I know that sometimes it's hard to praise God, but what I found in my walk, and I'm sure to work in hours, is when you find it hardest to praise is when you need to praise Him the most. If you can just put on something, I don't know what you like. Me and Pastor like Hezekiah Walker, but I can just put on Pandora and go to contemporary Christian, and you never know, but God does, and He'll play just what you need to praise Him to. And right in the midst of that mess, if you can just raise up a pinky, hallelujah, and give Him a little bit of praise, pretty soon you'll raise up a couple of fingers. And then you probably get a whole hand going. You might find yourself hopping on one foot. You might have to pull the car off the highway. But you might just be praising Him and people riding by looking at you. But you won't care, because if you get in that praise place, it won't even matter what you're going through. But I found out in my life, when I can praise Him in the mess don't seem to be a mess anymore. As a matter of fact, I just see God glorified in it, and He moves that very hour. Somebody give Him praise if you believe that tonight. I got to move on. And that the Gentiles might glorify God for His mercy. As it is written, for this cause I will confess thee among the Gentiles and sing unto thy name. And again He saith, rejoice, you Gentiles, with His people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and laud Him, all you people. I like to say praise the Lord. I'm at work, I'm just like, glory. And people will be like, about what? I'm like, because He is. I mean, sometimes you just got to praise God, hallelujah. Look, it's easy to praise him in here. But sometimes just say, praise the Lord. I mean, glory. Look, you never know what somebody might overhear you. Somebody might be in their mess when you're on the mountaintop, and they might just hear you praising. And they might say, you know what? I'm in my mess because I ain't praising, hallelujah. I need to praise the Lord. Somebody give him some praise right now if you believe that, hallelujah. Praise is a byproduct of being born again. If it ain't in you, I ask if you're saved. That's a fact. You got to praise him. Jeremiah said, it's like a fire shut up in my bones. Jeremiah got tired of getting beat. He got tired of getting stuck in the pit. They put him in the stocks in the heat of the day, give him neither food nor water. He got tired of it. He said, Lord, I ain't doing it no more. I ain't going back down there and preaching. They ain't listening anyway. And he sat down a minute. He said, oh, never mind, Lord. It's like a fire shut up in my bones. Even when I try to be silent, I got to preach, hallelujah. Look, there's glory to God. You ain't got to stand up here with a mic in your hand to be a preacher. You can preach at Ingles. You can preach at McDonald's. That's a hard place to preach, but you can do it. You can preach there. Now, we live in Griffin. Y'all don't know about our McDonald's, but it's rough. It's hard. I'm not even kidding you. My friend come in. She said, she's on the phone with corporate office. I said, Robin, just, they ain't going to do you no good. She said, I'm calling. She's coming in to get her hair done. She sat down there. I said, what's wrong? She covered her phone. I went to get a Frappuccino caramel latte, fatte, mooche, yummy, creamy, and they didn't have it. And it's about the fifth time I've been by there. She got back on the phone. She said, sir, I don't want a coupon for a free one. I can't get one. I'm trying to pay for it. I said, sister, I told you that wasn't going to do you no good. I knew because I'd already called. Come on, somebody. That wasn't a lack of faith. That was a fact. Amen. Let me tell you what else Joseph kept. He kept his vision. He kept his dream. What did God say to you? Let me tell you, I don't know what he said to you, but I know what he said to me, and there's been a rough way getting there. You hear me? Things look like they were going good, and the wheel run off. Come on. But God ain't finished with me yet. Look, just because it looks like things might not be going right, you just keep going forward. You just keep trusting God. Let me tell you, you can't lose your vision. The Bible says people perish because of their lack of knowledge. They also perish because they have no vision. They just want to sit here and everything's okay, and God birthed something in everybody in this room. He didn't save you not to birth something in you because he's about birthing. He's about reproducing things. He don't just save you and say, now you sit here, honey, and put your Bible here and your blanket here and make your rump fit this chair just right. And if anybody sits in it, make sure you run them out of it. That's not why he saved you. He saved you to birth things out of you. He saved you to do a work in you, praise God. Look, when you get thrown in the pit, there ain't but one where to look. I mean, the only way, it's all you can do. I mean, you can look down if you want to, it's just going to be dirt in your dirty feet. There's an advantage to being in a dry pit. You ain't in the mud. There's a better chance of getting out. I read a story one time, they got a mule out of a well. You know how they did it? They filled that thing up with dirt. They threw a little dirt in there at a time, and the mule got up, and they threw some more dirt in there, and the mule stood up, and they finally filled it all the way up, and the mule came right out of the well. But Joseph didn't have any friends throw dirt in his pit. Matter of fact, they were glad he was in there. They wanted to kill him, then throw him in the pit. But he had one good brother. Hallelujah. Good to know you got one good brother. Amen. 1 Samuel 2:6-8. The Lord killeth and maketh alive. He bringeth down to the grave and bringeth up. This is one of my favorite scriptures right here. Listen to this close, church. I want you to get this in your crawl right here. You hear me? Because when things are going bad, you just remember God's got you down there to bring you up. He ain't got you down there just to keep you down there. He's got you down there to get you somewhere. Amen. The Lord maketh poor and maketh rich. He bringeth low and lifteth up. That's a good word right there. Woo! That means when you get way down, you got a way up experience coming. Amen. That means when you get real broke, you got a real prosperous time coming. Amen. But you got to obey the word of the Lord. You got to do what he says. Hey, when that offering bucket's out here, put something in it. The Lord told me one time, never come before me without an offering. If it's a penny, he wants something in that bucket. What is it? I mean, what's a dollar to you? Think about it. Every time you come in here, if every one of us give a dollar on Wednesday night, we'd have 50 more dollars a week. That's $200 more a month. Come on. Give it to the ministry you want to give it to. I ain't going to get on you about tithing. I ain't your pastor, but I can tell you this. Tithe! Especially if you broke. You know, the Bible don't say save your way out of... The Bible never says save your way out of poverty. It says give your way out of poverty. Look, let me tell you this. God said in one place in the whole Bible, he said, test me, try me in this. He said, just try it. I mean, come on, church. How much faith does it take to give 10%? He wants less than the federal government wants. Woo! And I get a lot more return, I can tell you.
Well, you preaching that prosperity gospel.
Hogwash. Let me tell you this. If I'm sowing watermelons, I'm growing watermelons. If I'm sowing oranges, I'm growing oranges. Now, God may, the devil told me my whole life my kids weren't going to college. Both of them graduated from college. Give God praise for that. Amen. Let me tell you how much I spent. Little. You know why? Because I tithe, so God made a way for me. I ain't bragging. I'm just telling you what God will do if you do your part. The Lord maketh poor and maketh rich. Look, 2:8. He raises up the poor out of the dust and lifteth up the beggar from the dunghill to set them among princes. Now, I wonder in this story how that applies. Let me think. Now, here's the youngest boy, his father's favorite, gets his favorite coat torn to shreds and thrown in a hole. I bet it didn't smell good down in there. What you bet? In a dry old dusty hole. And look, all he did was give them two dreams he'd had. He stuck to them dreams. Even his daddy rebuked him. He said, boy, you don't need to talk like that. They don't nobody like to hear that kind of talk. But later in that same verse, his daddy, it said though his brothers were angry about it, his daddy pondered those things. So he might have rebuked him, but in his heart of hearts, he thought, maybe there's something to this vision that Joseph had. Amen? And, of course, we know, it goes on to say, to make them inherit the throne of glory, for the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he has set the world upon them. Let me tell you what's too hard for God to do. Nothing. Let me tell you what else he knew. He knew God was faithful who promised. Hebrews 10:23 says, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful who promised. If you don't think God's faithful, throw your Bible in the garbage right now and go back to whatever he was doing before you come. But I can tell you this. He is faithful. He has never failed me. Never failed me one time. I failed him. I can't even begin to tell. I can't even count the times I failed God. I ain't always been a good witness at McDonald's. I ain't always been a good witness at my family. I mean, sometimes I fail at being a good witness. I mean, don't we all? That's a crisis in itself, but I just ain't got to that place where I'm practicing walking on the water yet. Come on. But I can tell you this. God's faithful. Who promised? Hebrews 11:11 said, though through faith, also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age because... What? Because she judged him to be faithful. She believed God for the promise. Abraham believed before Sarah did. Abraham never doubted that the promised child was coming. Now, Sarah did what I did sometimes, tried to help him out. She said, you know, Lord, getting late, and we got to hurry this on, Abraham. I mean, I know God promised, but here's Hagar, and she can fulfill the promise. Maybe that's what God wants to do. And Abraham never argued. But he had a child with a handmaid, and we're still fighting him even today. 2 Timothy 2:13 says, if we are faithless, he remains faithful because he cannot deny himself. Man, what a scripture to hold on to right there. Oh, people say, oh, you didn't fail, God. You do. You finished. Turn to 2 Timothy 2:13 and tell me what that says. He's faithful. Church, he's faithful. In your pit, in your crisis, he's faithful. In your bills, he's faithful. In your employment, he's faithful. You hear me? Your car might be broke down today, but he's faithful. One time I prayed, I said, Lord, I need a car. I mean, I need a car. I had five of them things. Then one of them run, but I had five in my yard. My neighbors, they come up to get their hair cut. They say, what you starting in there, a junkyard? The only one that run was a primered Volkswagen Fox. Had the best heat in the world in July. Had no air conditioner at all. Had that old-timey air conditioner right here. Y'all remember that? Some of y'all remember that, don't you? We got Alyssa out there one day. We was raking the yard up. She's sitting in a golf cart. Me and her mama raking grass up, putting it in a buggy behind the golf cart. She said, it's so hot out here. And all she was having to do is watch her little brother. Man, times have changed, ain't they, brother? I told Rob, I said, let me tell you, I can see my daddy sitting in the, out here raking, and me sitting in the golf cart, whatever. My daddy worked me and worked me and worked me until I decided one day I was going to get paid to work if I'm going to work like this. You know what a weed eater was when I was growing up? We had a chain link fence around an acre. You know how we weed eat that, me and my brother? On our hands and knees. My dad get us up, he said, come on, boys, we're going to do some yard work. I said, not today, Dad. I got to go wash dishes at the Western Sizzling. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Joseph knew that his future wasn't in that pit. His future wasn't in that pit. His future wasn't in his past. His future was his future. It ain't about today, and it ain't about yesterday. It's about what God's doing today and tomorrow. Come on, somebody. Look, today is going to be gone. Tomorrow's already passed. Ain't a thing you can do about it, but there's a whole lot God can do tomorrow. If we'll believe him for it. Just imagine where Joseph got to. He believed God for his victory, and he got it. He knew God was with him. He knew it because Jeremiah 29:11, and I got the NASB here. I know it's on the screen, but it says, for I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for your welfare and not for your calamity, to give you a future and a hope. Come on, somebody. That's a promise right there. Can you believe that tonight? If you can believe that, turn to your neighbor and say, I believe it. In Genesis 39, in verse 2, is it up there? The Lord was with Joseph. And he was a successful man. The Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man. Put up verse 3. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and what the Lord made all he did to prosper in his hand. Now, Joseph started in a pit. Now, church, listen to me. This is just halfway there. He's at Potiphar's house. Go down to, what's the next one, 29 or 21? But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. Now, he started in the pit, sold into slavery, went to Potiphar's house, did everything he could with a spirit of excellence. Potiphar said, I got to have him. He's a great guy, exalted him above everybody there. He goes in one day. His wife had a thing for him. She's like, come on, lay on the bed with me. He said, I can't do that. I love my master too much. He went to fly out of there. She jerked his coat off, snuggled up in the bed with her, said, he tried to rape me. Joseph never said anything at all. He didn't say, I've been to church, Lord. I've been tithing. I've been giving. I've been praying. I even went on that Daniel fast and ate hummus and peanut butter and all that other stuff. never said a word, and they threw him in prison. And it says right here that he got mercy in jail. What's the next one, brother? One more. The keeper of the prison did not look into anything that was under Joseph's authority, because the Lord was with him, and whatever he did, the Lord made it. Man, what a word. Do you know what applies to him applies to you? Turn to your neighbor and say, that applies to me. Come on, somebody. I'm going to tell you, I mean, we can whine and we can feel sorry for ourselves, and we can do a million other things, but I'm going to be honest with you. It's just about trusting God. If you're in the midst of it, you just hold on a while. God's going to deliver you. And in the midst of that, you just keep praising him. You just keep paying your tithe. Look, the devil's going to try to break you. He's going to say, oh, you can't give today. Your car done broke down. Go on and give. Somebody fix your car. You'll be surprised what God will do. He knew God would save him. Peter stepped out on the water. You know why? He trusted God. Boisterous. It was terrible. Stormy sea. I've been there. There's like a canyon that comes out on the Sea of Galilee, and they say like this hurricanic winds, these tornadic winds come through there, and they get twisted in this canyon and come out on the ocean, and it's like a nightmare to fishermen. And here they were, and here comes Jesus, who's walking on the water. Woo-hoo-hoo. Probably singing, he set me free, he set me free. They said they were fearful. They thought he was a ghost. He said, don't be afraid, it's I. And Peter said, Lord, if it's you, bid me to come. Woo! Talk about some faith. Now, Pastor, I'm sure the other guys in our boat were like, shut up, Peter, shut up. He said, come. And Peter, the Bible said, without hesitation, it didn't even say that he hesitated or anything. It said he stepped out on the water and began to go to him on the sea. Church, think about it. Began to go to him on the sea. But then, here come the devil. He must have gotten his ear and said, oh, look at the water, look at the wind. You can't do this. And he began to sink. But he said, Lord, save me. And the Bible said the Lord took him by the hand and put him back in the boat. And the sea calmed. Wow. Like Abraham traveling to sacrifice his son, his only son, Isaac. He'd only waited 100 years for him. God said, gather up some wood, a couple of donkeys and two servants. We're going to go up a mountain and sacrifice your son. Abraham loaded up the donkeys, got the servants, and headed that way. On the way up there, his little boy said, Daddy, where's the sacrifice? Whew. Church, when I read that, this is my son, my only son. He let Abraham lay him all the way out on that altar and raised the knife up. And an angel of the Lord said, wait! Don't do it. Now that God says, seeing that you honor him, obey him, fear him, he's going to provide a sacrifice. And he saw a ram stuck in the thicket. Glory to God. Church, God's got a ram in your thicket. All he asks you to do is be obedient. Amen? Come on, somebody. Like Daniel in the lion's den. Now, all Daniel had to do is obey the decree. He could have went in his secret closet and prayed, but the Bible said he went right back to the house, opened up the windows, and began to pray like he always did. And they took him directly down to the lion's den and tossed him right in there. And the king, who wasn't even a Christian, wasn't even an Israelite, wasn't even a Jew, he believed God for Daniel. He said, Daniel, I believe the God that you serve will protect you. And he ran back down there and said, Daniel, are you okay? And Daniel said, the God that I serve has kept me. I hadn't been touched. Come on, somebody give him praise. Amen. How about three teenage boys in the youth group said, you got to bow down and worship this image. And they said, oh, Nebuchadnezzar, we're not going to bow down and worship your image. For the God we serve is well able to deliver us. But even if he don't, church, that's a stand right there. You hear me? Them three boys took a stand. I'm talking about teenagers. I've seen some teenagers make my faith look like mustard. Not mustard seed, just plain old mustard. Those three boys right there, three of them. They said, we don't, look, they standing right there at the fire. I'm not talking about, they're not uptown with their friends talking about, oh, let that Nebuchadnezzar come up here. I got something for Nebuchadnezzar, let him come on. No, they're standing right there at the fire, and they said, King, we ain't bowing down. Our God will deliver us, but if he don't, we still ain't going to bow down because we trust our God. That's the Roach version. Nebuchadnezzar got so mad, he said, heat that thing up 10 times, hotter than it was. And they throwed them boys in there. It killed the guys that threw them in there. That's how hot it was. Threw them in there. And King Nebuchadnezzar, I just got this picture in my mind, don't y'all? He like. It said his servant said, King, what's wrong? I mean, he must have changed his countenance. He said, I don't know, but them boys in there dancing, and they got a fourth guy with them, and it looks like the Son of God. Hallelujah. Somebody give God praise. It's one thing to get thrown in a dry pit. It's another one to get thrown in the fire pit. Come on. And the Bible said he himself went to the door, opened it up, and said, boys, get out of there. Come out here. And when they come, you know what I like? It said they bound them in their coats and their hose. I can tell you something about hosiery. That stuff don't last long around a fire. I mean, it goes up right quickly. You hear me? We used to do a little fishing. I don't know about y'all, have you ever doing the cat fishing with some hose? You stuff liver in it? Some of you old guys, some of your women look at me like I'm crazy, but you get done with that thing, you just toss it in the fire. That thing goes up like a marshmallow. The Bible said when them boys come out, nothing on them was even touched by the fire. Not even a hair on their head was singed. Look, it killed the guy. Listen to me, church. It killed the guys that threw them in there. And not even a hair on their head got singed. Do you know the same God of them three boys is the God you serve? Somebody give him praise if you believe that tonight. One more scripture and I'm done. He knew God would punish his offenders. And he knew God had put him where he was for a purpose greater than his own. He knew God put him there for a purpose greater than his own. Let me read this last scripture. Put it up for me, brother. Romans 12, 17 through 21. Repay no one evil for evil. Have regard for good things in the sight of all men. If it possible, as much as depends on who? You. Live peaceably with all men. It don't say this, but God spoke to me even at McDonald's. Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Church, you got to remember something about God. He can do a lot more than we can in 5 seconds. You can hate and be mad, show regret, and take people to court. And just pray for them. Forgive them and pray for them. And God will bring it to pass. Don't run from your problems. Don't regret what you can't change. Take your problems to Jesus, every one of them. Take them all to him and leave them there. It used to be an old song that said, take your burdens to the Lord and leave them there. You know why a lot of people walk around with their head cast down when they're Christians? Because they ain't leaving their burdens with the Lord. You still tote. If you believe him for salvation, believe him to deliver you from the burdens that you're facing today. 2 Timothy 2:19 says, the solid foundation of God stands having this seal. The Lord knows who are his. Whew. The Lord knows who are his. And let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. I pray that God would make you righteous and help you love what he knows. Because you can't be righteous without it. There's two works of sanctification. The first work of sanctification happens the day you get born. Boom, sanctified. That means set aside for God's purpose. But there's a second work. It's up to you. Which means you want to be more and more and more holy every day. You want to put off the things that beset you. I had a message about that. Y'all want me to preach that? No, I'm just kidding. I had 2 messages this time, so the Lord's going to have me preach it to you. Praise the Lord. But listen, God is good. Remember, a pit's temporary. Don't run from your problems. Give them to Jesus. There's not a problem that you're facing today that he can't heal. I don't care what it is. I don't care what you're facing. He can heal it because he's the healer. Stand up all over the room. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Molly, will you come? Father, we just thank you tonight and praise you, Lord God, for what you've done in our midst. Lord, I thank you, Lord God, that, Father, there's so many lessons from the pit. I just could just skim over a few of them. Lord, you give me so much, and Lord, I just thank you for that, Lord God, that you give me this opportunity. But Lord, there may be somebody under the sound of my voice, Lord, that's in a pit right now. And I want them to know that, Lord God, you can deliver them. You can set them free from that pit. More than that, you can set them free from the worry of that pit. I'm sure that in the flesh, when Joseph was thrown in that pit, Lord, that he was nervous. His flesh was probably saying, how am I going to get out of here? But then suddenly he remembered, God is faithful. And if I don't leave anybody in here with anything at all, I want them to remember this one phrase, God is faithful. He says, I'll never leave you and I'll never forsake you, even until the ends of the earth. Lord, I thank you so much for that promise. Lord, I thank you for the promise that says, you know who are yours. Lord, your sheep don't get away, and Lord, you don't lose them, and because you know where every one of them are. Lord, you leave the 99 to go find the one. Lord, in my own life, you left the 99, and one Easter Sunday, you reached out of heaven and touched me. And God, my life ain't never been the same. And I thank you so much for that, Lord God. Lord, I was in my own pit. I was in the pit of drug addiction and alcoholism. Lord, you delivered me. And there may be somebody in here today that's struggling with that or has a family member that is. But, Lord, I just want to pray for anybody that will come down. Lord, we thank you tonight, Lord God, if there's anybody here lost, we want to see them saved before they leave. You may have sat on a church pew for 20, 40 years and never confessed Jesus as Lord over your life. If you've never prayed the sinner's prayer, then you've really never confessed to Christ that you're a sinner in need of salvation. If you've never done that, I urge you to do that tonight. Don't be a church person. Don't let that religious spirit keep you from knowing the fullness of the born-again experience in the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, I thank you tonight. As Molly plays for just a minute, if there's anybody here tonight that needs prayer, we want you to move out, come down. And Pastor and I are going to pray for you, and some of the men of God that are here are going to pray for you, and some of the women of God are going to pray for the ladies. If you have a need, I want you to come down tonight and let God meet that need. I know it may be getting late, but we're all right. I mean, if we got a need right now, what's more important? Getting home and watching whatever you recorded, or getting into bed, or I got to work tomorrow. We all got to work, but let's let God have his way right now. Let's just let God have his way, and let's not let nothing hinder us right now. You know, this is when the devil wants to move in, and he wants to say, oh, don't do this, don't do that. But if you're here, don't let the devil keep you in your seat. If you need prayer for anything, I want you to move out. I don't care what your pit is. I don't care what your problem is. You ain't even got to tell us. You can come down and bow down at this altar and tell the one that died on the tree for you. He'll hear every word. And he'll move on that need just as quickly as he can. But if you want us to pray for you, you move out of your seat as Molly begins to pray.